You're listening to Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. We're here on the unceded traditional territory of the Salish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations. This is Bernadine Fox, here with my co-host for the week, Don Wright, bringing you Both Sides Now. You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio, 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox. Welcome to our show.
And I'm co-host Don Wright.
Our show today focuses on what is PTSD, which is post-traumatic stress disorder, and why we should know about it. Most people understand post-traumatic stress from the perspective of a military veteran who returns home from being deployed and who comes back with a psychological injury. We will discuss that type of post-traumatic stress in a later show, which we are currently putting together. But today we're going to focus on PTSD, which can develop in other scenarios that are not the extremes of war or battle. So let's look at just some stats to get us warmed up. Women are twice as likely to have post-traumatic stress than men. In fact, 10% of women, as opposed to 4% of men, will experience post-traumatic stress in their lifetime. It does not always develop after experiencing direct trauma. Witnessing violence can cause post-traumatic stress as well, and it's important to note that not everyone who experiences trauma will develop post-traumatic stress, and not everyone who manifests post-traumatic stress symptoms will do it in the same way as the next person. Sexual assaults are more likely to cause PTSD than any other form of trauma, and the development of post-traumatic stress can be delayed. It can take months or even years for post-traumatic stress to surface, even up to 2 years later, and for those with childhood trauma and dissociation, that can be much longer. Vicarious trauma from post-traumatic stress can be passed from parent to child or from client to trauma worker. And people who are disadvantaged are more likely to experience post-traumatic stress. And oddly, people in rich countries may experience post-traumatic stress more than those in poorer countries because it develops when your expectations of safety have been violated. And oddly, Canada, us nice people up here, actually has some of the highest incidences of post-traumatic stress. So those stats are from an article that we will post on our website after this episode airs. And today we're talking to Michelle Brezinski, who is an actor turned director producer in film and has experienced post-traumatic stress. And before we get into what happened to Michelle, I'd like to get you to fill in any other bio that you would like us to know about you at this point.
Well, I also was working since 2005 as a first responder and fitness instructor. And the public facilities are quite unpredictable. And that's where I had experienced the trauma that developed into PTSD about a year later.
When you say public facility, what does that mean? I'm not quite sure what that term means.
Well, public facilities as in pools, fitness centers, parks, you know, transit is a public facility, places where you're working with unpredictable circumstances. And in my case, being a first responder, I was also responsible for the safety of the individuals at these public facilities.
Ah, okay. That makes sense. So can you tell us a little bit about what happened?
Well, it was December 2006, and I was out for a break, and I had come back and was told that somebody was having a difficult time downstairs in the fitness center, and looks like he banged his head. So I went downstairs, ended up in the men's change room, and he was sitting on, there's quite a big triangular bench, and he had his head in his hands, and I could tell that this person was quite disoriented, and immediately I sort of sat down, squatted down to say, how are you doing? And immediately he went into a seizure. Mm. And It's amazing because I still feel it as if it was today, and it was a long time ago. I had my radio, and I said, you need to call 911. I don't know what's happening here, and this man is going into a seizure. I was very fortunate to have some individuals within the facility that was a nurse and a firefighter and a friend of his as well, because as I was digging through my bag to get the pocket mask, because we were immediately going to go into CPR because this person was losing their life right in front of us. And the man who was there, who was a friend of his, said, I know this man. I'm going to do mouth-to-mouth. You do the compressions. And we went to work. And me with a group of people, we laid him down. We started the CPR. The person was turning gray. It was really obvious that this person was dying.
Right.
And you do CPR. You're not sure if it's heart-related or stroke-related or what's going on, but that's all I have within my abilities to help keep someone alive until paramedics arrive.
Had you determined that his heart was not beating when you started?
Well, it was very, very faint.
Right.
But when somebody passes out, you sort of go into your CPR mode because the other variables, the person hadn't broken a bone, didn't hurt their head. You're just looking at something where there's a faint heart. You can't quite keep it. It doesn't feel like it's active, and the color's changing. So the circulatory system looks like it's struggling.
Right.
Well, yeah, and also if he's unconscious, you can't test his speaking. If
That's
he's
right.
able to speak, you'd be able to tell whether it was a stroke.
Exactly. And I was very fortunate as well to have a couple of other individuals in the room that were aware of the symptoms and immediately, you know, we had to bring the gentleman down. We had to make sure that he was comfortable. It was quite a nice big size bench. So instead of being on the floor, we were a little bit higher. We worked on him for quite a while, and we could see the change in his skin go from gray to a little bit of color. So obviously our actions were giving him blood flow, but he wasn't coming to. There was a little bit of aspiration of the brain, I think, that makes it seem like the person is regaining consciousness, it's a bit of a facade. We thought maybe he was coming to. We put him on his side, and it was a false call. We brought him back. We kept working on him, and it was just terrifying for me, because being a first responder, you're not really like a paramedic or a police officer or a firefighter, where you've got gangs of people around you at all times.
Right.
You know, you're on your own.
And probably not the equipment that a paramedic would have.
Exactly. And the training and the regular occurrence that you're exposed to on a regular basis, the confidence, right?
So can I just quickly ask a question? Do public facilities have those...
AEDs?
Yeah.
I don't know at the time back then we did.
That was quite
this
a while
was a while ago.
Yeah. Okay.
The paramedics did finally arrive. Now, there were other things that were happening. The person was out. The color of the skin was back to gray. Blood was now coming out of the nose.
Mm.
So there was more to it than a heart attack.
Right.
The paramedics then went to work, and they had discovered there was a bit of a faint pulse happening, and they had an AED, and they shocked the individual, and they were unsuccessful. The interesting thing about, which I would have not known at the time, was that they leave the deceased there.
Wow.
Mm.
And I think that was the hardest part for me, was that I was alone with the dead body for quite a while.
Wow.
Unfortunately, I don't know what happened to the rest of my staff, but the one person who was left was responsible for closing the entire facility down, and so I was there alone. The deceased's friend was out in the hallway making sure that the males did not go into the change room to see what was there, and so I was stepping over the deceased on a constant basis, going into lockers and helping gather the belongings for the other patrons.
Oh my God.
And it took a while before the coroner came to pick up the individual. And, you know, you think you're okay. And I recall having a meeting with a trauma team with the Parks Board shortly after that. And, you know, you're scared. You're going, did I do anything wrong? What happened? What are the details? And I wasn't fortunate to get the details at the time. I do believe the individual was symptomatic of stroke and had been for a while, so this was a pre-existing condition.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought I was okay. I don't recall being sort of spoken to about work safe as an option. I don't recall being spoken to about post-traumatic stress disorder symptoms that can be delayed for a while and to be aware of them. We have an EAP counseling service that was always at my, that I could access, but I didn't at the time think that I was gonna need it.
Right, can you explain what, is it EAP, is that what
it's
you said?
It's an employment assistance program,
okay.
And it's specifically for any counseling due to distress.
Right.
It sounds like you may have been in a state of shock, which is why you wouldn't have realized that mm-hmm. you were traumatized until later on.
Yes, and I do remember that when it was a sudden awareness that this individual's life was slipping and we went to work, there was a part of me that I just felt like it fleed the room.
Mm-hmm.
And right. I went to work. I'm a very disciplined person, but I had never in my life seen a person die.
Right.
Right.
So about a year after, I started getting symptomatic.
And when that happened, what do you remember happening? Like, what were those symptoms for you?
The symptoms were just an overwhelming, impending feeling of doom.
Hmm.
And that death was coming for me.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And it was small at first, but it was almost like it was a ghost, like it was separate from me. Like it was as if there was something inside you that wasn't you.
Right.
Right. Was there something that may have triggered it coming forward like that?
Meaning?
Maybe death of a friend or something else, or even something on TV that would have reminded you of that incident?
Or a car accident, or...
It's hard to say at the time. Yeah. It's hard to say. Maybe I was suppressing it for a long time.
Oh.
And it just slowly creeped up.
Mm.
You know, I have a lot of tools for distracting myself from... you know, walking it off and all these things. So I said, I'm okay, I can just walk this off. And I think I got to the point where it wasn't something I could just close up and
right.
push away in my subconscious.
Yeah.
So were there more things that happened once you started recognizing this feeling of doom? Were there other things that were happening for you?
Well, then anxiety started to right. creep in, and panic attack. And then just agony. It was just a collection of agony around. It was almost as if it took a while. It just didn't happen as soon as the doom came, that it just was suddenly there 24/7. It came in cycles.
Hmm.
And it would cycle, and I would feel it, and then it would cycle away. And I'd say, oh, I think I'm okay. And then it would cycle, and it would come back, and then it would cycle away. And then the cycles got more frequent. And I recall going to so many healthcare providers for help. In fact, in 2008, which was just shortly after a year, I have a transcript that I was able to see. I saw a lot of transcripts in 2018 that I did some research to see.
Transcripts of what?
Medical transcripts.
Of your medical records?
Of my medical records.
Okay.
And I was able to look into the past to see what was written and what was diagnosed. And I have one, and You know, this isn't a slight against anxiety clinic, but I do believe in the DSM-4 had categorized PTSD as an anxiety disorder.
Mm-hmm.
It's now been recategorized as something else in the DSM-5 just recently. Right. But the documentation is there.
Right.
It's solidly there. The correlation between the impending feeling of doom and this the symptomatic of early stages of PTSD linked to the occupational trauma.
So they knew about your occupational trauma that you experienced.
But for some reason, there was a hesitation to fully diagnose it for what it was.
Right.
Which has me wondering if our system waits too long.
Well, maybe that when you first went in, the symptoms were not easily recognizable. And if they didn't know the backstory, they wouldn't be looking for something.
They had the backstory.
They had the backstory.
It's written right there. It's written right there. I've been having these feelings of impending doom, and death is coming for me, and I do believe they're linked to the guy dying at my job.
Wow.
And it's right there. In 2008, when I had my early infant stages of developing PTSD before they fully expressed themselves to a point where they were unbelievably hard to deal with, I believe that there should have been an early recognition, a removal from the location, proper treatment, and I would not have had fully expressed PTSD.
So I just want to go back from what you just said now. It, mm-hmm. it sounds like, A, you didn't take any time off, that you were back at work.
So this is the thing about my tools when dealing with specifically something like that.
Right.
It's better for me to be at work.
Right.
It's better for me to be distracted from something like that. That worked for me in the long run. Being home alone with this, all I can say, internal haunting was a death sentence.
I would think that often the reaction to trauma is dissociation. And if you're going back to work constantly after that is going to be a reminder, and it would probably trigger that disassociative process.
And I agree with you that in the early stages, when the symptoms were not something I needed to avoid, removing me from the location before they became something so grand that I had to avoid them. So if we go back to the earlier diagnosis or recognition or documented developing symptoms, if they would have removed me from the location at that point and got me the proper treatment, being away, alone, quietly would have been okay.
Right.
When it was in its full expression, being alone with them was terrible.
It was too intense.
Too intense.
Too intense. So you did see counselors right after the fact, and they didn't warn you that this could happen?
So I went to go see my employer's counselor, the EAP counseling that I mentioned. That's when I took advantage of it. There was a resistance as well to diagnose it as occupational PTSD. For some reason, this individual got it in his head that this was linked to my past and that I was to picture the people that had done me wrong in my life and think of myself killing them.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I know, it's absurd. It's absurd that you see the UBC clinic, anxiety clinic, not looking at the infant stages of developing PTSD. We're looking at the EAP counseling service, not wanting to sort of realize or document that there was developing symptoms of PTSD. Instead, we're going to go and suggest that it must be my past and my relationships with my dad or something, and have me picture myself killing these people.
Dude, that's bizarre.
So I'm just going to make sure I've got this right. You went to see the EAP program.
Yeah, that was my employer's counseling service.
And the person there, instead of dealing with the trauma that you, which honestly is an extreme form of trauma, at your workplace, jumped over it and said, no, we're just going to call that a triggering event and but we're going to deal with this, you know, so there was somewhat trauma that we don't really know about over here.
So I would say that, first of all, as this stuff was developing, I'm not sure what's happening to me. Right. So I'm not diagnosing myself at the time with PTSD. I'm saying, I don't know what's wrong with me,
right.
But I've never felt like this before. I may have had anxiety in the past with drinking too much coffee, but I have never in my life felt suicidal, felt like doom and death was coming for me, depression. I'm a fairly optimistic human being by nature. So it was a very, very foreign feeling to me. So when I went to the EAP counselor and I explained all this, that was his decision. That was his diagnosis.
Right.
Even though I had explained to him that I think it's connected to the death of the guy, I believe that it started after that, he would have gotten the same information as the UBC Anxiety Clinic. But because nobody's diagnosing me, I'm going along with the professionals.
Of course. That's what you're supposed to do as a client. Well, I'm just going to tear us away here, mm-hmm. and we're going to take a short break, but we'll be right back.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams I walked alone, narrow streets of cobblestone, neath the halo of a street lamp. I turned my collar to the cold and damp, when my eyes were stunned by the flash of a split the night and touch the sound of silence. And in the naked light I saw 10,000 people, maybe more. People talking without speaking. People hearing.
The sound Where do we find solace in the face of despair and imminent decay? Who takes care of the caretakers? What remains of one's identity when degenerative disease or illness chips away at formerly prized abilities, roles, and status? What are the lessons that carry us forward when we seem to lose all hope? These and many more questions are at the heart of the mixed program of contemporary dance, featuring new creations by local choreographers and dancers, Olivia Schaffer with Senescence, and Kelly McInnes with Blue Space, which will be on stage at The Annex, November 16th and 17th, presented by New Works as part of their 2019-2020 season. For more information, visit newworks.ca.
You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox.
And I'm Don Wright, co-host.
And we're here talking with Michelle Brezinski about workplace trauma. Is it possible to pick up on what we were just talking about and get back into that? Because it was a very fascinating tale of trying to tell people what was wrong with you and why, and having them completely almost discount it, like mm-hmm. it wasn't important. I mean, that's crazy making in and of itself.
Well, my doctor was pretty sure that I was suffering post-traumatic stress, but she's a GP, so there has to be, you know, somebody who is more of an expertise to make that diagnosis valid. And so she sent me to a psychiatrist, and only up until recently do I see his transcripts do have PTSD on them. So again, I'm not sure why, but it just seems a scramble. And I think as time went on and the distance happened between when I first developed the symptoms and the initial genesis, it started to become more of a question of what is this? Because the trauma is now further and further into time. We're now looking years. So, the psychiatrist, of course, starts loading me up with all kinds of medications.
Right.
And I would wake up in the morning like a piece of bacon being fried up in a pan. And I got really, really sick.
Mm.
Not only was I getting improper counseling treatment, but the medications were not appropriate for me. And I tried to explain to the psychiatrist that I am getting worse and worse and worse. And I just think that he was a young individual. Maybe he was fairly new in his practice. He just didn't know what to do.
So what was the time frame? This event happened in 2005.
Right.
So
no,
where
2006.
Are we? 2006.
So it happened at the very end of 2006.
Okay. So where are we now with the psychiatrist?
So 2008, wow. The beginning, is when I started developing the symptoms that were very obvious.
Right.
2009 was when I was with my doctor. She was sending me to all kinds of endocrinologists and things to find out what was going on with me. She as well wasn't sure, but she was, because you know the anxiety clinic did not diagnose it specifically as PTSD, so she's trying other options.
Right.
Then she's certain. So she says, okay, listen, I'm going to send you to a psychiatrist. And I go to the psychiatrist and he makes his diagnosis, doesn't tell me at the time, but I have seen through the transcripts that it has PTSD written on it.
Mm-hmm.
And the medication is just not working for me. I'm getting worse. And she also recognizes, my doctor, that the counseling therapy is just not doing me any favors. So she's saying, you need to stop that. We got to get you into a psychologist. And then I started getting EMDR.
Mm-hmm.
Mm,
and right. It's an excellent therapy, but it's too late once the PTSD goes into full expression. It was incredibly difficult to deal with because it brings up all traumas.
Yes.
So I was processing everything.
Oh, my God.
And so between being overwhelmed by trauma, by medication that is doing me no service and activating my nervous system in a far worse way, I went to the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
My husband and I just said, I'm not going to make it. I can't live with this agony. I can't help myself. I'm not really getting the treatment. I don't know what's wrong with me. And we went to the hospital.
And what did they do? What year is this now?
2012.
So before we talk about that, you talk about your PTSD was in full expression. What does that mean?
It's a hard thing to describe. It's separate from your cognition. It's not you. It's an agony. It's like your nervous system is responding to something almost as if it's in pain.
Right.
And it is so unbelievably unbearable that you can't live with it.
Well, one of the symptoms of post-traumatic stress is being in a hyper-aroused state and mm-hmm. overly reactive. And if that's where you're at, being anxious and being in pain, emotional pain, mm-hmm. because it's so intense, because mm-hmm. you're so hyper-aroused or mm-hmm. overly, that makes sense. Definitely.
Well, and if I'm reacting to something in my subconscious, I can't even help myself.
Right.
Did you have flashbacks at all? Because I've worked with some clients with PTSD, and very often they're having flashbacks, which brings it up to the surface.
I didn't have flashbacks, but I woke in the night screaming a lot.
Mm. Oh.
But I had no recollection of why.
Right.
There was a time where my doctor was certain that I was having my flashbacks in my sleep because I was taking 2 Zolpicons every 2 hours.
What are those?
Sleeping pills.
Every 2 hours.
Wow. I couldn't keep myself asleep.
Right.
It was horrible. And then she was like, oh my God, you need to change that. And that was the hardest thing, the sleep. I would wake up freaking out.
Hmm.
So I'm just really good at hiding, you know?
It's actually not uncommon for people who have experienced trauma to have a very difficult time sleeping. So,
and I was a champion sleeper before that. So for me, it was like somebody just suddenly shut the light off and that was it. I wasn't going to sleep.
Right. So you went to the hospital, and this is in
2009? 2012.
Oh my gosh. It had so you've been living with that for 3-4
yeah.
years.
And remember, it slowly made its way into something monstrous. It
right.
wasn't just a quick thing.
Right.
And, you know, I would think, okay, I'm okay. I'm okay. I can handle this. You know, it's kind of like you get a little lump on your, you know, you get a lump and you think, oh, this isn't a big deal, even though it's cancer. And then suddenly it turns into something else, and now you're at stage 4 cancer and you need help.
Right.
So I would say I was at pretty stage 4 trauma.
Yeah.
And so I'm at the hospital, and you have to, too, remember that the medications amplified everything.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
They were just not in the best thing for me. These particular kind. They were the typical antidepressants that people get for serotonin reuptake inhibitors. What ended up helping me were the old TCAs.
What's a TCA?
Tricyclic. they're old antidepressants that
okay.
they actually help you just sleep.
Oh. Mm.
Tricyclines? Yes, that's right, yeah.
Something like that?
They got back my sleep, and I battled the rest on my own. They got back my appetite and my sleep, and I used distraction therapy,
mm-hmm.
filmmaking, by the way,
yes,
to just focus on when the trauma decided to surface and have control and generate agony. I just sort of went to work and started making things.
And that was your old coping skill too. Talked about that.
That's right.
About going to work. But going to work where the trauma occurred
yep.
didn't provide you with the relief that you normally would have gotten. So
it's because the work had the location
yes.
stimuli.
Yeah.
Right.
And I wasn't aware that I was vulnerable to that.
Mm-hmm.
And so that, I guess, was constantly triggering.
But how could you know? You'd gone to see the counselors ahead of time. You'd mm-hmm. gone to see the EAP person. Mm-hmm. And nobody was saying, my God, this is a horrible thing that you went through. Mm-hmm. You may have post-traumatic stress. They were all just kind of going,
Let's, are you okay? Are you okay? Okay, good. Bye. Go back to work.
Yeah. Yeah, that's...
And you know, I also look at some of my transcripts from psychiatrists in hospitals, and I got a transcript that's one day, and a woman had transcribed my symptoms, and they look like PTSD, and they're really strong transcripts, and this was the psychiatric nurse. And then she has me go see the psychiatric doctor, and the transcripts are like two different people.
Oh my God.
And the one that he does, and now he's the expert, that's why she had me see him 3 days later. The transcript reads like I was faking it. It states in it that I believe her emotions are superficial in nature. She wants to be the center of attention, probably going to WCB. I was in shock because I had not mentioned anything about going to WCB.
And this is like many years later as well.
Well, that was a while ago, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's, again, I don't know why the reluctance to take my emotions as an indication that I am in serious pain and use them sort of against me as if I'm just some hysterical woman.
Well, maybe that's what you just hit the nail on the head, because I think every woman on the planet, well, maybe I shouldn't say that, maybe every woman in Canada has been treated as if she doesn't know what she's talking about, mm-hmm. or and had things minimized and dismissed, and when bad things were really happening for them.
Yeah, it's even when we went to the hospital, it was my husband that pretty much talked them into having me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's this new, I've not seen this before, this diagnosis, but it's histrionic traits.
Oh, no.
And it looks to me, and I am going to be really honest here, it looks to me like a throwback of old-fashioned...
Freud.
Yes, it does.
Wow.
It really, really does. And it's using my emotions as if I am going in there and doing performance theater. Wow. Now, those histrionic traits come with a list of a lot of symptoms, and the only one that I really fall under is heightened emotions. And seriously, if heightened emotions are going to be a diagnosis that someone is coming in and doing theater, it's stunning to me.
Yeah. We need to take another little break, but we'll be right back.
Away from the sun again. Life makes sense, and now I can't tell what I've done. And now again, I found myself so far down, away from the sun that shines to light the way for me. And now again, I found myself so far down.
Vancouver Co-op Radio is a unique nonprofit radio station that produces creative and engaging programming for voices often ignored by mainstream media. We rely on the financial support of listeners like you to help us continue to produce innovative and hyper-local radio shows and podcasts. Please consider donating online at cooperadio.org/donate or by calling 604-684-8494. That's 604-684-8494. Thank you for supporting Vancouver Co-op Radio, your community radio and podcast station.
You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox here with Don Wright, and we're talking with Michelle Brezinski about workplace trauma. So, Michelle, the story of you trying to get help for something that honestly is a very well-known response to trauma, and you certainly experienced what anybody in their right mind should consider as trauma, is a bit horrifying.
Well, and you would think, too, that the emotions that I was expressing, I wasn't on crystal meth. You know, I'm a middle-class woman, and I'm in pretty darn good health. I have a great husband. Why would I want to get into the hospital if I wasn't seriously suffering from something? Right. It's actually quite shocking to me that, you know, if my husband is there and he's saying the same thing, I'm clearly not suffering domestic abuse. What was going through their minds when they were scrutinizing my motives? That's the question that I'm asking every healthcare provider out there that decides that something else is up other than the validity that this person is suffering something legit.
Don, I'm going to put you on the spot and,
sure.
and ask you, what do you think is going on? Because Michelle and I are coming from it from the perspective of being
right.
a woman and having the experience. And so we may actually, not that you are, Michelle, but we may actually be simply, that's our filter. But you're a man and you're a therapist. So what do you think is going on when that happens?
Well, I think there's a number of things. I think there are some people who can't cope with certain psycho-emotional conditions, and so they will minimize it. They'll try to label it as something they can handle.
Mm-hmm.
So, oh, you're depressed, I'll give you a prescription. They don't really want to deal with why you're depressed. What's the backstory? That's part of it. I know that some EAP programs, they're really kind of contracted to get the employee in and out quickly. It's a limited service, and so they don't want to engage in some kind of in-depth, long-term process. But they're supposed to refer to somebody who is prepared to get involved with the long-term treatment.
Mm-hmm.
And that may not be covered by the employer, but if you need it, you should be referred to the appropriate service.
Oh, but what about a hospital? I know of somebody who is very depressed and often suicidal and goes to a hospital and tells them I'm at risk of hurting myself, and they basically put her in a room for the night and give her a med and send her home the next day.
I think the emergency ward is not a good place to send somebody who's in a severe psychological state. I had a client that was attempting suicide. The police took him down off a bridge, took him to the hospital. They kept him overnight. This guy has a drug problem. He's homeless, and they turned him loose.
Right.
24 hours of observation. And so what happened? He went and made a second attempt.
Right.
Was found again and stopped and brought in. But I was able to get him into a treatment program. I just really hustled around and got him into a treatment program, which really helped turn things around for him.
A drug treatment program.
Yeah. But if we have clients that are suicidal, our first thought is not the emergency ward, because it's not a good option.
Is there anything that even remotely looks like a trauma treatment center in Canada?
Yes and no. I mean, my agency, BC Society for Male Survivors, the assumption is that all of our clients are suffering from some degree of post-traumatic stress disorder. Even though the trauma may have occurred many years earlier, it's being triggered, you know, maybe sometime decades later.
Right.
And so we recognize that there is trauma there that needs to be addressed and explored and supported. I think most sexual assault centers go on the same kind of philosophy. This person is suffering trauma, and we need to recognize it and address it.
So a trauma-informed approach is probably what you're talking about. Michelle, you've had a horrendous experience. What can you offer in terms of how we could do things differently?
Well, first of all, I'd like to mention about the hospital situation with me going and trying to get into the hospital because I don't think I'm going to make it.
Right.
They weren't going to take me in.
Right.
We had to beg.
Wow.
And I do not understand. Again, I'm not a meth addict. I'm not coming in with domestic abuse. I'm coming in and saying, I don't know what's wrong with me. And so why am I begging to even get 24 hours of, you know, to feel safe?
Right.
I think to me that I could break out into tears thinking about me having to beg these people to help me. But I like the idea, or I think the idea of having a trauma center of some kind in our city, especially with first responders, and you've got the presumptives that WorkSafe is now giving. The therapy and the treatment is vital. It's vital in the early stages, and we can't wait. A person suffering trauma cannot wait till it's fully expressed. That is going to be a death sentence for some people.
Right.
If all the other variables in their life are not solid. If I didn't have finances, if I didn't have a good husband, if I didn't have good health, if I didn't have discipline and health practices and tools and all these other variables, one missing variable and what I was dealing with, the bridge would have been my option.
Right.
Right. Well, my agency is trying to come up with the funds to move our head office into a heritage house with a crisis facility in it.
Mm-hmm.
So that when we have clients that are leaving a violent relationship or at high risk for suicide, we can keep them there in our crisis shelter where they can have 24-hour care.
So I just want to remind people that Don Wright is the past executive director and founder and still on the board of the BC Society for Male Survivors of Sexual Abuse. So when he talks about finding a place for people who are leaving a violent relationship or dealing with trauma and can't find these resources, that's partly why, is because the resources we do have right now are geared for women, and I don't think men can go to them, can they?
No, they can't. There's one in Alberta
that
will accept men leaving a violent relationship.
Okay. So I just wanted to let people know that's what Don's referred. And Michelle, you were about to say something.
Well, I'm wondering too if, you know, a trauma center for occupational PTSD.
Right.
Because again, it's something different. Right. You're going through a guilt process when somebody dies, and just being around people. To me, when I did get into the hospital, I ended up there for 3 weeks. For a group of people that were going to turn me out, ended up keeping me there for 3 weeks.
That's pretty profound.
So what was really, really great for me was, A, was the first time I was removed from the location. B, was that the medications were taken away from me, and the appropriate medications just for helping me get my sleep and my appetite back were put in. And that made a big difference and cleaned me out of all the stuff that was not doing me any favors. Mm-hmm. And then also I got therapy on a regular basis and spoke to a bunch of wonderful nurses who, there was one particular man who had explained to me the trauma that he had gone through in India. I do believe he was in the military,
mm-hmm.
and hearing the stories of recovery, mm-hmm. and the hope for recovery was so important to me. And that's why a place that that offers some therapy for occupational PTSD or anything to do with military, first responders, RCMP, I just think that's that kind of specific therapy for those specific people would be exceptional in our province, especially now since there are presumptives.
Right.
Do you think that part of the problem we're dealing with is that people, professionals, first responders, I don't know, I'm sort of throwing names, labels out of my head. Do you think that part of it is that they don't think that women can have post-traumatic stress, and that, because I remember when we first started dealing with sexual abuse in the province of BC, which is a long time ago, and we started to realize that people had post-traumatic stress, we were actually really attacked by people who said that's not possible, only people who go to the military and have been deployed can have PTSD, you can't imagine that a child would have it. And so I'm wondering whether or not there's some vestige of that still going on, that women can't have PTSD because they don't do any...
I think the historical background of understanding PTSD, World War I, they identified shell shock.
Right.
And of course, it was all men on the battlefield.
Right.
World War II, it became battle fatigue. And then later on, they started identifying PTSD as a product of a lot of different traumatic situations, first responders, and certainly sexual abuse. So I think that people have their biases. I think what happens in some cases, some hospitals, they may lack the funding, they may lack the beds, they may lack the facilities, and so you've got to come in with pretty severe symptoms in order to really get in. I think that's part of the problem.
But maybe that would be an okay thing to say. I'm sorry, we can't give you a bed because we don't have the funds for it, instead of making somebody feel crazy that they don't need help, to be able to provide some framework or some assistance in some way, because what you went through, Michelle, shouldn't be what you went through.
Well, I don't think they should diagnose the emotional intensity.
Oh, of course.
And that's what I find is that there's this biased perspective that if her emotions are that extreme, they can't be real.
Oh.
And that's kind of what I felt was happening to me, was that they didn't understand that that my emotions were probably quite extreme, because I felt as a woman I wasn't being believed, mm-hmm. and I had no choice but to be louder with my experience.
Right.
And that worked against me.
Yeah.
When you went to the hospital, did you tell them about the event that triggered all this? Or did
I don't recall what I told them, because we're looking at 2012.
Right.
It had now gone, there's so much time had passed.
Yeah.
I was still unsure what was happening to me. And so it just became a mumble jumble of agony that I couldn't link to anymore, because too much time had gone by.
Right.
If we look back at the original transcript from 2008, there was the genesis, there was the clarity,
mm-hmm.
but it got murky and murky and murkier as time went on, as other professionals got involved, and nobody was willing to sort of diagnose it for what it was, and it was occupational PTSD.
Right. Well, clearly,
I was going to say, I think that a residential treatment is probably better for that kind of thing. You can't go in for an hour to talk to a therapist and really get anywhere, because you're living with those symptoms all the time.
Yeah.
So I think a residential trauma treatment program where you could go in there, you've got the safety and you've got the support.
I would say too is as soon as it develops is to tell the person you need to treat it now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just like cancer, right? We have a little lump, we go, oh, I could deal with this. No, you need to treat it now.
Right.
If somebody would have said to me, we need to treat these symptoms now, because if they get out of hand, you're not going to survive this.
Right.
And that's what I wish somebody would have said to me in 2008.
A lot of really good information today. I think we'd be great if we had another hour, but we don't.
Yeah, what an incredible conversation, Michelle. Thank you so much for coming in and chatting with us.
The Kulch and Vancouver Asian Canadian Theatre are thrilled to present Kuroko, a world premiere from renowned playwright Tetsuro Shigematsu, at the Kulch Historic Theatre, November 6th to 17th. Hiroshi only has 1 year left to live. During that time, he must somehow get his daughter Maya to leave her bedroom, something that hasn't happened in over half a decade. Maya is an extreme recluse who has spent the last 6 years in her bedroom exploring virtual reality, until one day, she meets a mysterious player online who challenges her to the ultimate quest, saving her own father's life. How? By visiting the scariest place in real life, Suicide Forest. For tickets, visit tickets.thekulch.com.
You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox. My thanks to Michelle Brezinski for engaging in an intense discussion about PTSD that developed in her workplace. We're also putting together a show on military PTSD, so stay tuned for that. My thanks to Don Wright for co-hosting with me this week, and to Disturb, Three Doors Down, and Sherry Ulrich for some great music. But most importantly, our thanks to you for joining in on our conversation today. If you have questions or feedback about this program or want to share your story or have something to say to us, we want to hear from you. You can reach us by email, bothsidesnow@coopradio.org, or via Twitter, @bothsidesnowbc. This is Bernadine Fox. We'll be back next week. Until then. Just words people say to be nice.